Get off your feet and on the edge of your seat. You're watching News and Views. How you folks doing out there? I'm host Kamal Dockett, standing in for Charlie Hale today. And on today's show, we have Brian Ireland. How you doing, brother?
I think you're sitting in instead of standing in.
Standing in? Oh, wow. So is there a difference?
Well, you're sitting, so you're not standing in.
Okay.
Let's be real technical here.
Of course. We're the news. We're not fake news. We have to be accurate.
And we're not the ultimate news either.
Yeah.
Okay. And then on the end, we have Pastor Mark Glenn. How you doing today?
I'm fine. Blessed.
Okay. We got a number of topics that we're going to be discussing today, but don't forget that you can write us at P.O. Box 924, St. Louis, Missouri, 63188. Also, you can drop us an email at newsandviews@knlc.tv. And please don't forget about our Facebook/KNLC channel 24. So on today's topic, last week, I kind of talked about MSD affecting my backyard,
right.
Not necessarily my backyard, but in the University City area, MSD is doing some upgrades to the River Depere. Many people may have seen it in the news. I went to a town hall meeting last week that had over 500 UCD residents at the meeting. And typically, these meetings might draw anywhere from 50 to 100, maybe 150 if it's a hot topic.
Right.
But this one had over nearly 500 people.
That shows people are engaged. That's a good
right,
thing.
Exactly. You know, and we were giving updates from our local council as far as what MSD plans are. The problem with the situation is that they're trying to build three-story tanks. Keep in mind, these are three-story tanks like the size of a house above ground instead of building it underground. And what the tanks will be for is for when it rains and you have a lot of wastewater and different things coming through the sewers line, they can back up into these tanks. And then when the rain goes away, they can slowly release the wastewater back into the drainage system. So many of the people are in an uproar because MSD is going to come in and wipe out 30 homes, buy out 30 homes in the area to do this project. In addition to that, the homes that are left will have to have these 40 foot tanks that's 180 feet wide, literally 10, 20 feet from their house, destroying their property value. This is a side note. MSD was voted in by Missourians in the 1950s to monitor and to do upgrades to our sewer system. And so they're not a conglomerate, you know, like Ameren or American Water, but they're actually a political fraction of our government.
So where are these tanks now? Like, are these... Like, where are the tanks that need to be repaired now? Why couldn't they just replace whatever's functioning, whatever's doing that function now is not in these people's backyards?
Right.
So why are these going to be put there?
Like right.
There has to be something that's doing that job now somewhere.
Right. See, and because of how University City is located, our sewer systems is connected to surrounding other counties also. So what happens is that when it rains, the pipes that run through UCity is being backed up, and it comes up in people's basements, the little sewer holes in people's basements. It comes up through their backyard and their front yard, so it's being overwhelmed. So they're saying that the pressure point is UCity. If we can put these tanks in UCity and create a backup system, then it will
alleviate. So these are new.
These will be new tanks. The tanks don't exist now.
Okay, that's what I was wondering.
But 30 houses?
They're saying 30 houses.
I mean, that seems like a lot.
Right, but you got to keep in mind they have to be able to access the service. They have to create a service road to get to the tanks. Then they have to perhaps build walls and fences around the tank. You're talking about two tanks that are 180 feet in diameter.
And who's paying for this?
The EPA, the EPA is giving MSD $4.7 billion to do this project over the next decade. So you might see the signs. It's called the CLEAR Project, CLEAR Water Project. You're seeing them all throughout the state of Missouri.
Now, are you for or against this?
Well, I'm for the upgrades to the sewer system, of course, because there are hundreds of homes that are being affected
that are being flooded.
It's for the
greater good, because while these 30 homes, that's not good for them. Think of the whole region where they won't have to worry about all of this backwash.
Well, let's clarify this now. Now, we're not talking about rainwater, because when my sister had her home and everything, when it rained, rainwater would come in. Right. We're talking about
sewage. We're talking about
sewage. But how does it come into the?
Because they have sewer lines. When the sewer lines are being overwhelmed, they're using water to clear those sewer lines out. When it rains, the sewer water and regular water is backing up into the system. So, like, you know, you heard of sewer lines before, right? So they use water to clear those sewer lines out. When that sewer line backs up, it backs up into people's homes. And you have a flood zone up and down. If people are familiar with Olive Boulevard, from Midland to 82nd Street, it's called the flood zone.
Now when that happens, when the waste floods in, right?
Right.
Who's responsible for removing that waste out of your home?
You are. Okay, because so MSD is saying that it's not their problem, you know what I'm saying? Because the river DePere runs through University City. So they're saying that it's really technically not their problem, because U City should be fixing this. And then there was some argument that American Water should be in on this. Okay. So there's been this really big, you know, debate.
So everybody's passing the buck.
Everybody's passing the buck because it's going to cost several
million dollars.
But the problem with it is that in the neighborhoods, they're saying that we want the project to be done, but we want the tanks to go underground. Put the tanks underground. And Ms. D is saying, well, that's going to cost more money to do that, but they have a $4.7 billion budget to do this. And keep in mind, they have 10 years to do this, but they're asking people to get out of their homes in the next 30 days.
Wait, hold it. Stop. Repeat that again. They ask people to get out of their homes in the next 30 days.
Or they're going to...
And they have a 10-year project.
Right. Or they're going to eminent domain the neighborhood.
Which means that you would probably get nothing for your money. I mean,
well,
for your
house. They would have to give you eminent domain. You have to give a person fair market value for their home. So just say, in that neighborhood, those homes are valued at around 70 or 80,000. So they have to give them much money for
their home. So why the rush?
That's the big question.
If you got 10-year window,
right?
Why 30 days?
That's the big question.
Well, it's a rush if you're one of the houses that's getting all this waste in your basement. You want it done as fast as you can if you're one of them.
Right, but why would you cause 30 different families, 30 different homes, to move out in 30 days?
Right, that's the big
question.
Somebody's
got to move. Otherwise, the project it has to go somewhere.
Right, I mean, and that's the debate is that...
It's not going to be
perfect.
Right,
the work has to be done.
It's never going to be perfect.
If it's 30 families in 30 days, I bet you it takes them 10 more years to get it done.
Well,
we don't know. But, I mean, we need people to be prayerful about the situation. And maybe, you know, we need more people that's maybe willing to contact MSD. So, anyway, what do you think out there? You know, you can contact us at P.O. Box 924, St. Louis, Missouri 63188. Also, don't forget you can drop us an email at KNLC, newsandviews@knlc.tv. You're watching News and Views.
Thanks to New Life Evangelistic Center, thousands of mothers with children around the world can stay together. They can pursue their educations, and they grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank you to all of our Club 24 members who make this miracle happen.
Well, welcome back. At this time, we're going to kick it over to Mark. And you had some, Pastor Mark, you had some interesting topics about some stuff that's been in the news lately.
Right. Now, the problem I think we have today is that we live in a very offensive society. We have incidents where a politician tackled a reporter. We have politicians that have been using the F-bomb, the B-bomb, the C-bomb, all kinds of different bombs. We have people who are just bullies who find things offensive and don't apologize or double down on it. Now, recently, I watched a program on HBO. It's called Bill Maher. I think it's called Real Life. Real Time. With Bill Maher. And we're going to play it for you. But when I saw it live, well, let's play it for you. We'll come back.
Comedian Bill Maher is facing backlash after using a racial slur on his HBO show Friday night. His guest was Republican Senator Ben Sasse of Nebraska. When Maher stated he should go to Nebraska more, the senator said,
"You're welcome. We'd love to have you work in the fields with us."
Work in the fields?
That's part of that. That's
Senator, I'm a house. No, it's a joke.
The senator later took to Twitter, noting, "Free speech comes with a responsibility to speak up when folks use that word. Me just cringing last night wasn't good enough. Here's what I wish I'd been quick enough to say in the moment. Hold up. Why would you think it's okay to use that word? The history of the N-word is an attack on universal human dignity. It's therefore an attack on the American creed. Don't use it." Numerous other reactions followed. But really, at Bill Maher has got to go. There are no explanations that make this acceptable. Oh, Bill Maher, that's going to be in the news tomorrow.
Now, when I first saw this live on HBO, and when I heard the Ben Sasse say, "Come work in the fields," and Bill Maher said, "Work in the fields? I'm not a house in," I took no offense to it. And as you notice, Ben didn't either. Ben kind of chuckled a little bit and went on with the interview. But later on, there was a big outcry about Bill Maher using the N-word.
Right.
So we need to talk about that. When is it appropriate to use the N-word? Should Bill Maher apologize? People are actually asking for him to be fired from HBO. And the other thing that really ticked me off.
He was fired, wasn't he?
No, he's not been fired from HBO. Okay. But the real thing that really ticked me off was Ben Sasse. If you notice what we showed you, he was not upset. He didn't say, "Hey, Bill Maher, you shouldn't have said that word. You're out of line. You stepped over it." But later on in the tweets that you saw in the video, he comes back and chastises Bill Maher and really puts him down for using the N-word.
Yeah, I think the problem has been that we're living in a culture that word is, the N-word, has been used amongst African Americans on a daily basis to identify themselves. Not only do you see it in the culture, but you also see it on TV and a lot of the programs that are on cable. They're using the N-word. You definitely see it in the music as far as the rap. Yep. The rappers, yep, use it and refer themselves to as N-word, as the N-word. And I think that white America has now been using it in recent years, not on that level, you know what I'm saying, as far as on the news or in some type of news setting, but they use it in the culture also. And I think that has become a problem.
Right. So you're saying that people who, white people who have black friends, and since black people have been using the word over and over and over, right, they feel liberty to use it around their friends. Therefore, it may go out beyond.
Right. Because it would have been unheard of.
But you can't
of.
Censor people. They have a right to say words. I mean,
that to a degree is true. But when words are offensive,
then you have to, and there's the consequences of saying them.
Right. And
I'm saying, if you say that word and you're a white person and a black person takes offense to you or even hits you, then that's the risk that you've taken. If you're a rapper and you say the word, you just can't regulate a word that people say. I mean, it's a free country.
Yeah, but that's true. But we know that there's been generational words that we just don't use, that we stay away from, that white America, black Black America. There's certain words as a black person, if I say it, you know, growing up watching Archie Bunker and the Jeffersons, you know what I'm talking about.
Right.
There's certain things, words you just don't use because it's a stigma. It's a force. It's
but he was making a joke. Yeah, I mean,
yeah, but see, that's
even
how you
admitted you weren't offended, and Ben Sass wasn't offended. I mean,
right, but I can see where people could be offended by it.
But people are easily offended.
I know Bill Maher. I know Bill Maher.
Sometimes there's a right. People have a right to be offended.
Right. So, but I know Bill Maher. I've watched him for years and years and years. I know that he is not a racist, right? And I know that also he gave $1 million to the Obama campaign when Obama ran. But the whole thing is, this is my opinion. The word shouldn't be used, period.
Oh, come
and,
on
and
now.
The word should not
you
be used,
period.
I get really offended when I listen, when I happen to listen to a rap song, and I don't listen to rap music all the time, and all I hear is
and.
I don't buy it.
Right?
I tell a person to turn it off because it's offensive to me. I find it very offensive. So
what
I
do
think
you mean
I think
to turn it off.
Right. I think what you should do is just ban the word, period.
On.
Well, I think that the word could be used in context.
In jokes,
I'm saying that,
white people
that this was a word. This was a word that was used to identify a negative. It was meant to demean a race of people generations ago. What happened was that African Americans thought that they could start using this word to identify each other with. So now you're looking at, if you go back.
But they're
back,
saying
if
it
you
a
go
different way 50, it, but than a white
it
racist.
It doesn't matter.
Among young you, black
can,
people.
Can you imagine Dr. King and Jesse Jackson
not,
having a conversation 50
we
years
don't know
ago
behind
and they calling
doors,
each other the N-word?
You never know.
That would be unheard
doors.
Of. But
not in public they wouldn't, of course. But I'm saying amongst black people saying it to each other in an affectionate way.
There's no affection in that.
You don't. Why
can't you use another word and say, hey, king? Hey,
you
queens.
Could.
You know what I'm saying?
That's fine.
Hey, prince.
You could, but you can't.
But they're using a word that's demeaning. Like
but
people saying, what's up, dog? Or,
right.
What's up, cat? I mean, these are demeaning.
But to them, it's not demeaning.
But right. It is demeaning.
But right. To them, they're not using it in that way.
The black culture came back and said, you know what? We're going to take the sting out of this word, so we're going to adopt it and call each other that, right? Big mistake. You can't take a word that's derogatory and call yourself and say it's affectionate. There is no affection. If you come to me and call me that word, I'm not going to find affection. I'm going to find offense and tell you about it.
So I
but you have women who call themselves bees. You have, and these are friends saying it. They're not saying it as a stranger.
So
it's still an offensive word. And
right.
So I guess you use the N-word.
No, as a white guy, I wouldn't feel comfortable using the N-word.
As a black man, would you use it?
Among black friends, probably, yeah. If I was black, amongst my friends,
so
I would.
Say, hey,
but a
yeah.
white person should not use it.
Okay, so I say, hey,
as a joke. He probably shouldn't have used it, but I understand he was saying in a joke.
Should he
as
be
a
fired?
Joke.
No, we have not concluded. Should he be fired?
I say no.
I would say
he has
should.
Not apologized.
Yes.
He's
right.
not apologized.
No,
he's
I think Bill Maher has
I don't
apologized.
Think, I think that it was in bad taste. I saw the clip.
It was probably
I didn't
in
see
bad
the show
taste.
Live. I saw the clip. I don't think that he should be fired, but I think that he should be told to never use the N-word again, especially out of context. Now, if you're using it in context to describe a certain time period, that's another
well,
thing.
Well, he was saying, I don't work in the field. His joke was, I would be in the house.
Right, I'm a house in.
Right.
Right.
Because the guys had come to Nebraska and work in the
but
field.
But he shouldn't have used that. He shouldn't have said that.
Okay.
Now, wait a minute. Now, are we chastising him saying he can't use
well,
it because he's white?
Yeah, right. I am.
Okay.
I'm saying because he's white.
If he had been black, would it have been,
right. would it been different?
No, it
if,
would
if
be
he
different.
Had been black,
it
would have been different.
Well, it would have been different
why?
Because it would be hard to say that, because when you're white and you say the N-word, that automatically is
right.
offensive.
But I'm not
right.
a house
I mean,
in. Wait a minute. I'm not a house in. I never had been a house in. Maybe my ancestors were a house in, right? So we go back around.
Okay.
You can't have a double standard.
Okay.
You can't say, it's okay
well,
for the white man.
Well, we're going to have a part two to this. We're gonna come back
right.
with this. So anyway, we're hot, heated in the studio. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Let's step up our game a bit and use those things we grit and laugh. And smile and say we're lucky to be alive.
Okay, welcome back. It's hot and heated in here. I wish we had some outtakes of the in between the camera shots, but we're talking about forgiveness in the media, and we know there's been different things going on in the media. Now we're going to talk about Kathy Griffin.
Yes, but before we go to Kathy Griffin, I want to read a scripture first, and then we can talk about it. Ephesians 4:32 says, "Be kind and compassionate, forgiving one another, just as Christ and God forgave you." Now, we have Kathy Griffin, who came out with the head of Donald Trump. And, of course, it was a bloody head, and she had a terrible, terrible backlash. Now, we're going to go to a video of her where she actually asked for forgiveness. She admits what she's done. She says she's sorry, and she apologized for it. But still, a lot of Christians are coming after her and not giving her any kind of forgiveness in accordance to the Bible. So let's go to Kathy Griffin, and we'll come back on the other side.
Hey, everybody, it's me, Kathy Griffin. I sincerely apologize. I am just now seeing the reaction of these images. I'm a comic. I cross the line. I move the line. Then I cross it. I went way too far. The image is too disturbing. I understand how it offends people. It wasn't funny. I get it. I've made a lot of mistakes in my career. I will continue. I asked your forgiveness, taking down the image, going to ask the photographer to take down the image, and I beg for your forgiveness. I went too far. I made a mistake, and I was wrong.
We see Kathy. She looks paler than normal. She's already pale, but she looks paler. Her hair is not done. She's crying. She's upset, and she actually asked for forgiveness. Now, we talked earlier about the N-word. We talked about Bill Maher, who has not asked for an apology. He's got a backlash, but he has not asked for an apology. Here we have Kathy Griffin saying, "Please forgive me." So should we as Christians forgive her?
I think we should have gave her an Academy Award for the performance, because the whole thing is that, you know, what if she had not been fired? What if the producers would say, "Man, the ratings were off the chain. You know, we're going to give you a raise, and we're going to give you an extra 30 minutes on your show." I mean, would she have been doing that apology then? She got fired. She's been ridiculed.
Her career's in trouble.
So you're saying comedy, the people in the comedy world are distancing themselves from her. Different tours she was supposed to go on has been canceled.
Right.
So is she doing this because of her career, or is she doing this because she was sincerely upset and she severe? Because these type of people are dragging Donald Trump through the mud.
Okay, so what you're saying is that her whole thing was motivated by money.
Yeah, because if this was in China or Japan or Russia, she would have been taken out back and a bullet in her head.
Ooh.
I mean, that's just real talk. You know, and I'm not saying that's what she needs to get. We do need to forgive her. You know, we do as Christian believers. And as even if you're not a Christian believer, we still need to forgive her and say, okay, if she's willing to apologize for making a mistake, we need to forgive her. So we don't want to never promote that we don't forgive her. But at the same time, is she only doing this because of her career?
What do you think, Brian?
She probably should have just stood by it. If she thought that was funny, then she should just stand by it. It's like, these are people, they're comedians.
Right. But
so every time you make a joke, then when you get in trouble, you take it back. Just stand by it.
Right, but that's the whole thing that's wrong with us. When somebody does something
people
offensive,
are easily offended, then you don't patronize them. Don't watch his show.
Okay, people are easily
don't
offended.
Go to her shows.
But how can
don't
you,
watch her on CNN.
How can you keep double down on something that you know is
wrong?
Because
it's insincere.
That you know is wrong.
It's like Kamal said, her career is in trouble, so she's like, "Oh, I'm really sorry."
But do you think there was a difference between
yes. what was done?
Right.
He used the N-word in bad taste, and then she actually put the leader of the free world head cut off, bloody. I mean, she just overdid it. And then on top of that, it was kids and other people watching this. Even the president's son thought that her father, his father was.
Yeah, but the son should have known better. Obviously, he knows that.
I mean, he's 12.
I know, but he thought that was.
I mean, what if I cut your head off or had your head?
That'd be funny.
Your
kids, it'd be funny.
So you wouldn't be.
Yeah, because I'd be sitting there with them. They would. I mean, I probably wouldn't want them to see it. But
But what I'm saying is that we have to be sensitive. We have to.
I agree with that.
The Bible does
agree
speak
with
about
being sensitive.
How we deal with our
but
leadership.
But she thought it was
so
funny.
The whole. She thought it was funny, but how did the Trump family feel?
Well, of course they're going to be offended, but the presidents are made fun of all the time.
But the whole key word is this, civility. Whatever happened to civility? I mean, there are certain things that we talk about today that we wouldn't even mention about. And I'm not talking about things that are taboo. I'm just calling each other names back and forth and ridicule one another.
How far do we take this? Because if you have a person that can come on TV, cut Trump's head off, show it all wrapped in blood, what's the next step? We're going to show him getting shot up with a machine gun, or we're going to push him off a building. I mean, how far do we take this?
Okay, but wait a minute. Where was the outcry when certain politicians said the F word and said the B word, right? There was no outcry saying, hey, wait a minute. These people are running for campaign, running for president.
That's
opening the door. Don't you understand? It's opening the door for more offensive dialogue, more offensive talk.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that was that directed, what Kathy Griffin did was specifically directed towards Trump and his supporters as a whole, because that was offensive. Now, if you use the B word, the F word, of course you're not supposed to use that type of language if you're in certain positions, but is that really directed towards someone as an individual?
Let me put it to you differently. If the politician said the F word or the B word, right, and I am watching that person as they campaign, right, and I have my children around me, I don't want them to take look at that person and say, you know what, that's going to be the next leader of the free world. And he said the F word, so you can say it too.
Well, yeah, but then you just don't vote for that person if you find him
offensive.
Yeah, but
we're too late. How much of this stuff is people seeing on TV with their local actors, their entertainers? You know what I'm saying? True. How much of this is already in the culture?
But
politicians now are reflecting the culture.
But you would shield your children. At a certain comedian, you would say, nope, you can't watch him. Or a certain program, you would say, no, I can't watch him. How can you possibly have a person running for the president of the United States saying the F word,
saying the
B word, and you don't even know it's coming through?
But this is the question that we have to pose. Doing a particular job and having a sense of morality, does that go hand in hand? We know that you should have a sense of morality, but can you do a job and yet still have some quality flaws? Because we see it with Donald Trump. We know Donald Trump has flaws, but can he effectively run the country? Is the question.
You're asking me that question.
I know you're Hillary bound, but you know what I'm saying? I don't know. Hillary has flaws.
Hillary has flaws too. But Let me hold my breath. Okay, let it go. Okay? I'm not even going to answer that question because I think those who are watching TV know all the different flaws that this president has given us. But we're not, the topic isn't the president. The topic is mostly Kathy Griffin, forgiveness, and Bill Maher not asking for forgiveness. I think we should give Kathy Griffin, I think the persecution should be over. We should forgive her for what she's done, restore her, reestablish her. Okay,
but you can't have people like that on TV. I mean, at the bottom line,
you can have them, just don't watch them.
And that's true. But what I'm saying is that certain times there are certain things that people do in the media. You have to make examples of them, and because you don't want to set a precedent of people coming on TV with a cut off president's head on their show, and I bet you won't nobody else do that in years to come.
Right, I understand. I agree, and I
know Brian may feel, you know, disagree, but what if I was to come on News and Views with a cutoff Ireland, Mr. Ireland.
I think it'd be funny.
Cut off Brian. I think it'd be hilarious.
You can't just censor everybody.
Can we order that? Can you call Kathy Griffin
Some
and
people
order that?
Like that kind of humor. We might not like it.
Well, we better ask Kathy Griffin to get an order before
she
gets shot in the head.
All right, boys, we got to get on out of here. But I want to thank everybody for watching News and Views. Don't forget that you can write us P.O. Box 924, St. Louis, Missouri, 63188. Don't forget you can also drop us an email at newsandviews@knlc.tv. Once again, this has been Kamal Dockett. You've been watching News and Views.